So welcome to the Footie Show. I'm here with Ian Hart and AJ Wood, and we're going to be discussing the Crystal Palace home game, 2-1 defeat. Tough one to take, wasn't it? Ian, really tough. We were there at the game. Talk us through it.
Well, we don't need to talk through it, Mark. You know, it was extremely disappointing. You know, 75% of the play, 25 shots on goal, 13 corners to nil, and we end up losing in the 95th minute. Palace came, parked the bus, took the wheels off the bus, and it was one of the most disappointing nights in recent years.
Yeah, it was tough. AJ, I mean, we should have taken the lead earlier on, shouldn't we? And that was a big, you know, we had all that pressing and we just couldn't quite find a goal, could we? And to be fair, the Palace keeper didn't have any saves to make first half, did he?
That game was a carbon copy of the game at Selhurst Park. They had one shot, scored it. It was from a penalty. And we had all the possession, all the chances. We basically controlled the game. In that game, we managed to get a late equaliser and probably were pushing for a second to win the game. But this time, it's gone against us and it's going to keep happening. It's going to keep happening.
AJ, it's going to be like Groundhog Day, though. AJ, we're going to keep playing this video of us saying we had all these chances.
Yeah.
And we didn't win.
Ask them exactly. It happened last season as well.
Where do we, they've obviously clicked, they're playing attractive football, but ultimately goals win games, which is why strikers command the highest transfer fees. Where are we going wrong?
You've got two options. You have a plan B. We have no plan B. It's literally we play the same way every time. Yeah, we change from a five back to a four back, but we still go down the wings. We still cross it into Trossard and Mope, who have got no half the height of the centre halves. Or we play someone with a bit of height, with a bit of pace next to Mope. Mope's not that sole striker. He can't play on his own in there. He plays as like a number nine, and he's not good enough to play in both positions like your Firminos and stuff. And he hasn't got the wingers that can go next to him. So, yeah, he's going to score you 10 goals a season, but you need someone out with him that's going to score another 10 or further because it's not every time. We've got, he scored 7, Mope, half of them probably penalties. And the next highest goal scorer is 3, Lewis Dunk. You're not going to compete.
Yeah.
But Mope's come in for some horrible, horrible, horrendous criticism. Really, really bad.
So you see
but
it?
I see in the stand, AJ, I saw there were 14 Albion players on that pitch, not one. We can't just blame it on one player.
Unfortunately, when there's no goal, when the goals are drying up, the first person to blame is the striker. And that's unfortunately how the game works. Obviously, people that know it a little bit more, like ourselves, will look at it in a wider space. No midfielder scored any goals this season. McAllister scored 1. Gross has probably scored 2, I think. 1 from the penalty spot. Trossard 2, and he's playing basically as a second striker. Our defenders are scoring more than our attackers from open play. So we really are struggling for goals. And Graham Potter at the beginning of the season said he's looking to get more goals from the strikers that they have. Unfortunately, they don't have the quality of striker. If they had Danny Welbeck 10 years ago, maybe. But he's one game out. Andy Zakiri's probably a championship level right now. Aaron Connolly the same. Neil Mope needs someone alongside him to score the goals. Yeah, I think Glenn Murray is probably exactly what we're looking for right now. We've always said that we don't need, we need someone with pace, and maybe in the past we did to run in behind, but we don't create chances like that anymore. We create chances by building it up and getting in the box. You look at the chances we missed. Glenn Murray would put 9 times out of 10, he'll put them away if it fell to his feet. We just need someone that can hold the ball up. I know people are going to hate me, but you look at Mateta from Palace at the weekend. He had one chance. He held the ball up every time it got to him nicely. Yeah. Someone like that for Brighton is outstanding. Just to accompany Mope up front. I think they, little and large, complement well.
Yeah.
We just need someone up there with him.
Yeah. I mean, Ian, do you think it was a mistake to he's now left the club, but should we have kept hold of Murray, do you think, Glenn Murray?
Can't look at life through the rear view mirror. No. We have to look forward. And the thing is, you could talk about Welbeck 10 years ago. Welbeck was playing for Manchester United 10 years ago. He was, there's no way he'd have joined us then. But I don't know. It's just really a frustrating season with all this COVID malarkey and there's no fans in the ground. And I'm loving getting back to the ground, but I'm missing the buzz of the crowd and the fans. And we need it back. It's almost, and I've put in my Brighton Hove Independent column this week, it's almost a game of snakes and ladders. We go up the ladders when we beat Leeds, Spurs and Liverpool, and then we land on the bloody hugest snake you've ever seen in your life, and we're right down the bottom of the board again. You know, yeah. we are in a relegation scrap now. And a couple of weeks ago, when we were talking about back-to-back Amex games against Aston Villa and Crystal Palace, we were saying, oh, yeah, well, this is a we can kick on here. Muggins here said we're going to get 45 points. I still think we can. But we've missed out. You know, we've had two home games now. We got 1 point out of a possible six. And we should have had so, you know, we had that many chances.
Yeah.
That we really
Question for you two. Graham Potter, is he to blame or is it the players? Can he only do so much? Because he's every week was having 25 shots, should like clear cut chances, defending very well with the odd mistake. What do you think?
Well, no, I don't think you can say blame Potter. And I was in the anti Potter faction. I've put my hands up and said I was in the anti Potter faction. Although there was a very funny thread on North Stand chat on Monday night, but I'll come to that later on. Ultimately, if you're creating all these chances and not scoring, our questions have to be asked about the recruitment.
Yeah, and that's not all down to Graham Potter, is it? I mean, everyone was saying he needed a strike, but before the start of the season, and we didn't really buy anyone, did we? We didn't really spend the money that you need to, you know, like the Villa, you know, Villa, it's paid off, hasn't it?
But there's not a money tree. Yeah, but, you know, the one thing about, many things about Tony Bloom, he loves the Albion and he's a shrewd businessman. He's made his money, but we've spent a little bit on some dross in the transfer market. And I think he had his fingers burnt. And I think the problem being is that he's not prepared at the moment to spend the kind of money you need to spend on a proven striker in the Premier League.
Yeah, the trouble is, you look at it
in the Premier League, we are going to have to cross that threshold for the first time in the club's history where we're going to have to pay someone £100,000 a week, and it isn't going to happen. Because he won't do it.
AJ,
and in a way, fair play to him.
Yeah, AJ, I think he's got a good point there because, you know, we do have quite a sensible wage structure, don't we, at the Brighton Hove Albion do?
Yeah, but you look at it and think, Lallana's probably on half of that. Do you think Lallana's paid off so far? And do you think he's going to get any better?
He's saying Lallana's on 50 grand a week.
Probably just below that, yeah.
No, I think he's on a little bit more than that, old love.
No, that's what's being reported, that he's on a lot more, but he's not. Trust me, he's not, because Lewis Dunk's on the high.
AJ.
See, I've seen some of it. I know some of it. I know that he's not on. I know he's not on the £90,000 a week that people think he's on.
Send me a DM. Whisper. Go on, let me know. But
for me, like, a striker is very obviously it's the golden ticket in the Premier League. Everyone's doing it though. That's the problem. If all your competitors are doing it, you're going to be left in the mud if you don't. Unless you've just all of a sudden turned Andy Zakir and Aaron Connolly into prime Pele, then you're gonna struggle. Connolly
as well.
Connolly and Zakir have got to go out on loan. They're both.
That's by the by. With the transfer window's over, AJ. What we've got to look now, we've got 12 games now, and we've got to have better results than Newcastle and Fulham.
Yeah, for now, it's all about having someone next to Mope.
Something that I want to pick you up on, Mark Walker. You said you didn't think we'd win another home game this season.
When did I say that?
You said it to me after the game.
Yeah, I don't remember. But yeah, I might. Yeah.
Did you not say that?
I can't remember that. But, I mean,
was it a knee-jerk reaction?
I think we got some difficult fixtures coming up. I mean, I think Newcastle's a possibility, but we can have 75.
What do you mean a possibility? We've got to beat Newcastle very least. That's not a possibility.
I understand back Mark's claim though. Well, yeah. You look at it since the last game at the Amex where there was fans, Crystal Palace at home, until now, Crystal Palace have won the same amount of games as Brighton at the Amex in the Premier League.
Things could change, couldn't they? So that's it for the first half. Join us for the second half. We'll be chatting a lot more to Ian Hart and to AJ Wood about the Albion, and we're going to be previewing the West Brom game. Welcome back to the Footie. I'm here with Ian Hart and AJ Wood, and we've discussed Palace, the 2-1 loss in the first half. Now we're going to move on a bit, aren't we, to some of the team performance against Palace and then on to West Brom. AJ, you've got something to say about Dan Byrne.
Not just Dan Byrne. I think Ben White had a poor game. I thought Bissouma probably had his worst game of the season. But for me, Dan Byrne is not a Premier League player. He makes so many errors that, like, usually because we have Lewis Dunk there and other players, usually don't lead to much. He made two huge errors at the weekend. He got spun by Andre Jordan Ayew from about 30 yards. Lewis Dunk also made an error for that by going to it because he thought Dan Byrne was completely beaten. And then obviously Mateta was on his own in the box. He done well to shrug off Ben White. And then the second goal, what is Dan Byrne doing? He the ball's coming over in the last minute. He's 6'7", and he turns his back on the ball, takes a step to the right. He doesn't know where the ball is because he's looking at Benteke, not the ball. That's like schoolboy football. You say, look, watch the ball and win it. You don't. That's ridiculous. He's taken a step to the left, to the right, and left Benteke. Yeah, good finish, but he's left him with basically an open free hit.
Yeah,
I think. Been a little bit harsh there, AJ. I think Mark threw you under the bus a little bit there, asking you about Byrne. But if we were taking 20% of the chances we were creating up at the other end, we'd have been 3-4-1 up in that last minute. I think the problem, because we're not firing up front, a lot of the mistakes at the back come under the microscope. And I think it is a confidence thing. I mean, going back to the playing up front, as news, and you can give us one of your injury updates, AJ. Florin Andoni, are we going to see him again?
He hasn't mentioned him in recent times, Graham Potter, in news conferences. I might bring it up this week. But
he was one of the bad boys that he bombed out of the club.
Yeah, he said he didn't like his attitude after that Southampton red card.
Bombed them all out. But, you know, it's never too late to mend. And
No. The rumour is he's on his way back.
Don't believe rumours.
Well, I can tell you he's on his way back. He's back training at Brighton.
But will he get a chance? Will he get a chance, AJ?
I couldn't tell you. He's back in Brighton. He's back. He had a bad ACL injury on loan in Turkey. And now he's... He's back. He's training light training, but yeah, it's kind of not as bad an injury as Chiedo, but I think they'll treat it as if with caution. I'm not sure you'll see him this season, to be honest.
You know, we touched on. Well, then there's no point. Then he'll get bombed out in the summer. We are in a relegation scrap now. Talking about the Lallana and Welbeck. It was a gamble signing them on.
Yeah.
Should they start at West Brom, AJ?
Well, the trouble with especially Lallana is he can't see out 90 minutes. So if you start him, you have to bring him off after 60.
Have him playing 70 minutes or 60 minutes and doing something and being creative and having a game won in 60, 70 minutes than bringing him on, chasing a game with 15 minutes left.
If you're being harsh, probably you wouldn't start him after the game against Palace. He missed two decent chances, probably the two biggest chances in that second half.
Yeah, one of them was clear. He should have put it away, you know, just inside a 6-yard box. You remember that? Or just he missed from, he just skied it over, didn't he? It was a brilliant.
Yeah, he missed two, one with his right, one with his left, both from either side, and both pretty clear-cut chances that you expect in the Premier League to put it away. I would start Welbeck against, if he can see out 70, 80 minutes, I'd start Welbeck alongside Mopay.
Yeah.
Like we've got to attack. We've got to give it to them. If we play with all these creative players again and get to the edge of the box and then think, oh, what are we doing next? Then we're going to struggle, even against West Brom.
Yeah. Come on. I've got to ask you, AJ. Tariq, where is he? Because next week, I'm going to bring out missing posters and pin them to trees and things like that. Where's he gone? Where is he?
Graham Potter said that he was on his way back and then suffered another setback. He didn't say what the setback was, but he... Yeah, every week it seems to be he's out for this one. He doesn't really give a time frame on it. So kind of, for me, we're missing Adam Webster as well. I think Joel Veltman has been outstanding at right back. I thought Joel Veltman has sat in for Tariq Lamptey outstandingly. But for me, the bigger miss is Adam Webster. Because obviously you're playing Dan Burnham there at the moment. Who I'm
top at the start of the season.
Well, yeah, he's come on leaps and bounds since the start, though.
Fairly into the season. There was a North Stand chat thread, Adam Webster is not a defender. Discuss. Like an O-level question. That's one for the teenagers. An O-level question. You know, and that is really bad. I think Webster has been an outstanding Albion player this season. Absolute quality.
So
going back to the Tariq thing, because I've got the bit between my teeth. Is it the hamstring? You know, or what's another setback? Has he got lost on the bus? Or, you know, what's happened?
I think it's another hamstring. He's, to be honest, he's had hamstring problems all season. Like Everton away, he got brought off at half time. That was a hamstring problem. There was a number of occasions where he got brought off at half time. That kind of people just thought, oh, it was just precautionary. But there's something underlying there
that's a serious worry then. Isn't it? Because we got him for a decent fee from Chelsea.
Yeah.
We're looking to sell him on for a big profit. If he's got a hamstring issue, no one in their right mind's going to pay serious dough for him, are they?
I agree. No. He's obviously him being young as well, having the hamstring problems is also another worry. When he gets older, the hamstrings are just going to get tighter and. It's gonna keep happening. So hopefully it's just a one-off, but hamstring injuries do have a tendency to repeat themselves.
Yeah, AJ, Potter did mention selling on players, didn't he, this week, I saw as well. So it's inevitable, isn't it? You're talking about Bissouma. I mean, he's probably going to be off. Who else do you think might be off?
Yeah, he gets asked that every week, unfortunately. Yeah. Bissouma and White are the two names that looking like. He basically said that, and he know Graham Potter, he sticks to the lines he likes saying. So what he said was, if people come in, bigger clubs than Brighton, come in with offers that Brighton feel are fair and they make profit on for your bigger players, then they're not going to stand in the way. And they said it's not going to be a bad thing if we sell the likes of, he didn't name these players, but he said, you kind of read between the lines, it's not a bad thing if you sell Bissouma and White for big profit, considering the pandemic, considering the money that we've lost as a club. And the players that we've got coming through, I think the Bissouma player like that.
AJ, what to you as a Brighton fan? Never mind this show. What when you're sitting there in the Costa Brava, you know, in July, sunning yourself? What is acceptable? What is an acceptable fee for Ben White and Bissouma? What will you say?
But
take that. Yeah, we'll go for that.
Obviously, Leeds had a bid rejected for 30 million for Ben White, so it's going to be in excess of that for Ben White. I think they're looking for 50 million. I think they'll settle for 40 probably. It also depends on what club comes in. If it's Leeds or people that are around that Brighton see as their rivals, then they won't just physically won't sell. Like regardless of whether they bid 100 million, they won't sell.
I don't think we should sell either of those two to anybody outside the top six.
No, I think that's a given. I think Liverpool are in for Ben White.
And I think 40 for, you know, each of them, but then it's down to the recruitment. Then if you've got a war chest of £80 million, please, 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 Mr. Recruitment Man, don't like you did on the likes of Jose, Lacardia, to a degree, Andoni, and AJ, the wonderful, the greatest player Iran ever produced. Sorry, they are not up to what we need at the Albion.
I think Jose Izquierdo has been a bit unlucky with injury. Obviously, before that, when he came in, he looked a very good player. Those yeah. one-twos he used to do, the goals he used to score, he looks a very good player. But unfortunately, injuries have almost not subsided his career because he's still quite young. But yeah, it could be a tricky one. And there's rumours that he could be back to Belgium at the end of this season.
Just before we finish up, then, we ain't got long left. So West Brom, I mean, how do you see that going? Start off with Ian, just briefly, and then AJ for a prediction as well. Predictions from you both.
Well, my predictions haven't been very good recently, have they? I went for the 5-0, which was 80-1, and I'd had a little bet on that. But I think we've got to go to West Brom. It you know, it's the biggest game of our season so far.
Yeah.
We've got to come out of the Palace hangover, and I think it'd be West Brom 0, Brighton 1.
Brilliant. AJ?
Neil Malpay. There you go. You can have that one for free.
It could go one of two ways, to be honest. They can take that defeat, that hard defeat on the chest, and really push on and take it as a positive and really get that victory at West Brom. Or they could go back into their shell and worry again. You know, when Brighton tend to do their get nervous and all of a sudden it just starts building up. That could happen. I don't know which way. I'm at the game on Saturday. So,
right, we'll leave it there. That's it. The Footy Show. Join us again next week, and I'll be speaking to Ian and AJ after the West Brom game. Join us then.